I've known Randy since 1971, and matter of fact, I was teaching basic design students, sophomores. Randy was a fifth year student. He would wander through my classroom. He would look at the different kinds of things that the students were doing. It was not the way he was taught. And his curiosity picked, meaning that he would come back and look and talk. And finally, Randy said, "Can I set up my design studio here?" He was working on a fifth year project, his final project in his final year of school. When he came in my studio, he really left his friends in the other building that they were working in their studio, the fifth year studio. And I know he took some grief from that from them, but he was willing to take a chance and learn something he had never learned before. And he does that in his architecture. He will take chances in his architecture. One is his final thesis now. Again, he took a chance with the final thesis. It was not a building. All the other students were designing a building and making sure that they had an expression of everything they had learned. Randy didn't do that. He designed a system whereby he could design all buildings. His end result wasn't a building at all. It was a massive 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 desks were filled with this three-dimensional model. Colors from Itten, shapes from Itten, shapes from different concepts about architecture. This was a catapult to the future. It was not a restatement of what he had learned in 5 years. It's unbelievably successful, and he uses that. You see it in the underground in Oklahoma City. He uses colors and shapes and forms. You see it in the boathouse that's in Oklahoma City, how it emulates the skulls which are housed there. You see it in Pop's Diner out on Route 66. It's completely a system where he understands how to create something that's new and beyond the pragmatics.
I met Rand 10 years ago. He came to New York City to see me in the office. I remember, here's this guy from Oklahoma on the other side of the desk, showing me project after project, and my heart started racing. Now, as an editor, I see thousands of projects a year, and that is so rare. So I'd have to say that I fell in love with Rand 10 years ago.
Well, first I knew of Mr. Elliott. I kept seeing all this really thoughtful and very sensitive work coming out of Oklahoma City.
The Heritage High School Athletic Center, Oklahoma Heritage Museum, Lyric Theater, Republic Gastropub, the World Neighbors Nonprofit, this amazing underground pedestrian tunnel, and the Uptown Kids. He's done all this work for Chesapeake Energy Corporation, and on that campus is a parking garage, a cafe, a restaurant, a theater, a fitness center.
Where's this work coming from? It's not a place you would expect really great work to come from. So I had been following Rand through his work for some time, and then I decided, you know, it's time to meet the man and put a face with the work, so to speak. So we invited him to the University of Arkansas to give a lecture, and it was really fantastic to see him present his ideas, his work. When I met Rand, I felt like, here's a brother. You know, this is a brother in the cause, and you know, the fighting the good fight, and really admire what he does, how he does it, that he's principled about it, that he's generous in spirit.
His first award, he used modern day materials, and it became almost structurally like an African village. And if you walked into this space, you could feel it, but yet everything was using modern technology, modern materials. But it felt like walking into an African village without looking that way. And I called him back and I said, "Randy, that's an award winner." And it was. It won a national award. It was his first national award. And I felt very, and matter of fact, Randy said, "I'll fly you to Chicago." And he did. And my wife and I watched him walk on the stage and get this award. It was a great feeling.
A special memory? That's easy. Route 66. So I went out to see him, and we were actually on a job site, and there's Route 66 in its full glory, stretching out before us, and here we are, and almost like ants on this huge highway, and he is showing me his project, this vision of a project, a man and a vision, and it was this mammoth structure. I mean, we were this small, and he was pointing up this high, and it was going to end up being Pops. And Pops, I guarantee it's going to be an icon in the city, and for me, it ended up being the cover of Interior Design Magazine.
I like to be influenced by the best, I've considered Rand one of the best. You know, the little airplane hangar that he took a very ordinary shed building, you know, that's not particularly honorific or anything, and you know, just the care and thought he put into making this an amazing building, simple, direct, essential. I mean, that's inspiring to me, because he demonstrates for me that architecture can happen anywhere and with any building type. You know, it doesn't have to be a museum or an embassy. He demonstrates to me that he can take an office and elevate it, just by the way he stacks paper to make it part of the walls. He affirms that you can take ordinary things, ordinary materials, ordinary places, and elevate them above the everyday.
People going through his places experience things that they have not experienced before.
It's really about great design, and whether they realize it or not, they are being influenced by that.
I think he makes extraordinary things out of relatively simple things.
Clearly, his architecture has exposed people to different thoughts, different ways of working, different ways of understanding. I have used that many times as examples in my architecture classes that I have since taught.
It, I think, really speaks to people when they see the work. It's not ostentatious. I think it speaks to a larger audience.
His projects are so varied and so wide that it touches so many people's lives.
It not only provides use, everyday use for people to inhabit, but it also, I believe, really moves them emotionally. And that's, you know, that's what he does. I think he elevates the spirit through his work.
I see Rand as an oak tree, and he has the roots that spread throughout the entire community, because he's pretty much designed the community.
They're better off for having experienced it, because in some way, their experience has been dignified when they engage a work with as much thought and care and craft that he puts into it. And I think people sense that. I think people are smart.
There's no question he's made a difference. No question.
I think Rand is always educating himself. In order to have that kind of global influence, he needs to have a much broader spectrum in his life. And for him, it's the arts. He's a poet. He's a photographer. He travels globally with his wife.
Frequently, educators prevent things. The most critical thing you have to watch out is, of an educator is, what is it that you're preventing? And with Randy, I did not prevent him from being himself. I, matter of fact, helped him the best I could.
He's obviously been educated well, but my guess is that Rand is constantly in the process of his education.
And his experience with his strategy on making all buildings, he became my teacher. And I think the greatest thing a teacher can do and have is have the student supersede what the teacher's capabilities are, and Randy did that.
A lot of folks, it stops when you get the degree, not Rand. I think he's constantly learning, he's observing, he's very attentive to his place and to the world around him.
Randy was, quote, in many ways not a student. He was a collaborator with me.
Three words I would describe Rand.
There are actually four words that I would like to describe Randy.
Have you met him?
How about the three P's?
I find Rand wonderfully strange, and I mean that in the best possible way.
The first one is curiosity. Now, if one has curiosity, it's not curiosity about everything. His ability to have this unique quality of selecting the right things to be curious about.
Passion, he has an abundance of it.
He never knew the end result of this curiosity, but he would follow it to its end.
Very eccentric guy, wears a duck tail and, you know,
oh, yeah.
Back. And
His second one is his ability to take chances.
A cape, he's worn a cape. So he's, you know, he's got these great glasses and stuff. Huh?
He uses a mantra of keep your eye on the sparrow, and that came from an old like proverb, Chinese proverb, of three archers trying to shoot a sparrow from a tree. The first one said, I can't see the sparrow for the leaves. The second one said, I can't see the sparrow for the twigs. The third archer said, I can only see the sparrow. And he's used that many times. And it's a beautiful mantra. Keep your eye on the sparrow. And he did that.
Rand is deeply honest. That's the thing about him.
I think he's driven. He's disciplined.
Even though his work is very serious, and he is a serious person, he also has an optimism about him.
He's just an extremely talented architect.
Randy does not deal with solving problems. He deals with the potential of a situation.
He's got a very sophisticated talent. He's moved beyond being merely facile.
What can be done with what you have there that goes far beyond the pragmatic conditions?
He's intense. He's very ambitious.
I think you have to have that if you want to build things. So he has this optimism and this integrity about everything he does.
And that's where he gains a great deal of success.
His work, his integrity, his approach is very pure.
And just a great spirit, you know, in the cause of architecture. That's what describes Rand to me.
And most people may not know this, but he is a poet. And it's extremely rare that an architect we'll start out a project using words instead of visuals.
I enjoy getting a poem from Rand or something. It's thoughtful, and again, it reminds me of his architecture. It's absolutely very taut, very essential, never too much, never too little.